biological data and genome database. Egil Tolsen, that is doing like a small sculpture with solar panels. And do-it-yourself biology from Christian Delgado, that is going to make a laboratory with do-it-yourself new technologies and new devices. So I hope you enjoy. We have 2 days, today and tomorrow, from 10 to 11, to 1, sorry, 3 hours. And now I'm, today the moderator is Nora Bagen, who has a PhD on ethical bio-art or science approach from artists and other people that is not specifically scientific. And we will start with Robertina. So I'll let Nora to introduce the today.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Maite. Might preempted a little bit my PhD status. I'm currently in the finishing stages of writing up my PhD, so I don't yet have a PhD. That's a fine distinction. I'm very glad to be here at Pixel to moderate this seminar today and also to speak after the coffee break. As might discussed, sorry, thanks. As Maite just said, bioart and DIY bio are new and emerging phenomena in a way, and they seem to be coexisting in a very complex way, and that's something that we'll see during these 2 days. Some feedback here. Oh, right.
Right,
should be fine. Okay. Well, I'm not going to say a lot now. I just want to emphasize the sort of blurry boundaries between DIY bio and bio art and bio design and all these different approaches that we have at the sort of fringes of biotechnology these days. And it's something that I'm going to say more about in my own talk. But for now, I'd like to just introduce Robertina Shibjanic. Is that okay? who's an intermediate artist from Ljubljana, who's working in bioart and sort of immersive environments. And Robertina is going to talk to us today about jellyfish. So looking forward to some fascinating imagery as well on that. Thank you, Robertina.
Hello. Thanks, Maite and Nora, for these nice introductions. As Nora introduced me, I'm Robertina Shibjanic. I'm working since a few years now very deeply on the topic with, which is very connected on the research of the behavior, environmental issues, and so on regarding jellyfish slash marine animals in general in the oceans and sea of the world. Like today in the public in, is also my colleague, which is collaborating with me a lot, especially in the support of the programming and software and hardware programming, Slavko. So you will have some more detailed technical questions. He can also help me out in the discussion. The project which I decided to present today, it's actually Aurelia 1 plus Hertz, which has two executions, like executions I mean as a visual presentations inside of the gallery slash art frames, we could say, but it's also, it's a project which I was like doing lots of residency, met lots of people through this. There was so many people to credit, so I will try it on the end to remember all the names to say correctly also. But like this is one of the image which we made in Izmir Marine Institute, where I was on residency, and actually it was a really interesting moment because at the moment when I came to residency, and the topic of the residency was the sea, But there was no jellyfish in the seas, and it was, everybody was saying, no, no, this year it looks very better and so on. But like 3 days after, they were just like pumping up, you know, and then to the end of my residency, it was like really swarms of jellies all around. And it was Aurelia aurita, which is like one of the species which I'm working a lot with, and it's one of the model organisms in biology also. So it's very, not, it's a bit maybe wrong to say easy, but it's very, I have feedback again, you know?
No,
it was you. No, but Aurelia aurita is one of the model organisms in biology. What means, this means that there is lots of data available, there's lots of people which they have been doing different researches already with them. And especially for me, which I'm coming from the field of arts, like I was studying sculpturing, I don't have like biologic like background in science in the sense that I would study it. But since I went into this field as an artist to work in this kind of environments, of course you try to understand and study really deeply something before you show it even, you know. Also, the sometimes executions of the art pieces, I think we could also debate with you, Nora, later this in our session, can be very simple in some sense, you know, but there is always some a bit more complex research in background. And this complexity is always a question how to show it, you know. Like, are you want to show all this complex stuff with all the graphs and everything, and it can be polluted in the sense of the visual presentations. Like, I had like lots of these questions actually pumping up. But for now, I will show you the video of the project. Oops. Like this. So just that you, like, I will show you two videos now. One is the installation, and another one is from the performance. Both they're working on similar topic, but are connected with my work with Aurelia aurita project. Like this first video, this first project, Aurelia 1 plus Hertz Protobeta Vivo Generator, is actually dealing about the relationship between the animal and the machine, because there is lots of robotical artificial intelligence and so on, which kind of has lots of inspiration coming from the animal world. And here we have been thinking with my colleagues a bit differently, and we said, okay, why would not be something that would be run by them, you know, by the organism, by the jellyfish. So then we decided to make a project where you see the jellyfish are actually, depending how jellyfish are behaving, what's happening with them in their kind of environment of the special tanks which we have for them. The robotic sculpture is kind of moving very slowly, very suddenly, but it's present, you know. So it's like the mechanism is depending from the organism, and not vice versa. You know? We're also trying to kind of. You know, there is at least transfer from water to the water, like from the water organisms to one object which is also in the water environment. But the idea is to talk also about this, like, I will come to this also later on, but not Aurelia aurita, but there is one jellyfish species that it was very fascinating for me when I started to read about them to kind of get to know the topic of it. Which is immortal. I have also photos, we will talk in my later discussion also about this, but it's like, it was so fascinating to get idea about one animal organism which kind of can live forever, you know, and there is this visual thinking in the human kind of relationship or human, like through the humanistical, philosophical studies, religion, everybody has this kind of like tendencies to kind of have this kind of prolonging their life, or at least to live or to be remembered very long through the work, through the presence, through something, you know. And when I was talking a lot with scientists down in Izmir Institute, but most of them, they told me, but also Aurelia aurita has really good regeneration possibilities, you know. It's like there's stem cells also when the adult organisms, they're present there, you know, so if it gets cut or something, it has some abnormalities, it's again very quickly reshaping back to the normal beautiful shape. And I was like, okay, that's very interesting, you know, because this wish for prolonging life, actually last 2 years it was a big boom, you know, like Google started to have their own company for having regeneration of the human lives and so on, like our lives are actually I'm now 40, like 200 years ago I would be kind of finishing with my presence of this earth, you know. And actually now I feel that I'm just like in the middle of my process of living. So this changes a lot also the So this changes a lot also our perspective on different animals, you know, and all this kind of like theoretical biological immortality starts to be very big field. Okay, here are some photos from the exhibition still. So, and there is a big debate also about it, you know, shall we do that or not, or like how far shall we go, you know, what is the ethical limits of prolonging our lives, because, you know, if you look from the biopolitical point of view, this means that you have like working force which will work longer than you, you know, like you have people which they will not work only till 56 years old, but they will work till 80, 90 years old. And this changes a lot also the social structures, you know, already this change is happening, you know, like there was like 200, 300 years ago, there was like families which they had like 3-4 generations living together in one roof or being present, know each other. Lately we're coming to 2-generation kind of family exchange, which is like really different scale and different thing. And I, as I said before, you know, sometimes it's really hard to squeeze all this information into the visual presentation of the project. So during my project in Galleria Kapelica, I decided to have this kind of more relaxed, because I really wanted to go deeply in the topic. But with symposium, sometimes, you know, people can be too stiff, especially if you invite also scientists and so on. And I was really trying to have this kind of more horizontal debate. So I invited people to have this kind of like in-between talk about cell technology, regenerative medicine and so on. And it was really nice, actually. Like Gino, who will be also later present also our institute and citizen science, what he's doing, he was also one of the speakers on the event. Then I invited also Luka Muhuric, who is working in the veterinary medicine. You know, like they have lab animal cell where they are doing lots of stem cell regenerative methods for healing dogs and horses mostly for their joints, you know, like with stem cells and technology. I invited Mojca Jež, which is working at the Blood Transfusion Center of Slovenia, and they're mostly working on this kind of like 3D printed heart organs, like inner organs, specialized on heart. And I was also talking, so so we had like this kind of debate, because it was good to have this kind of like idea of human animals in general, how this is kind of, because on animals, this stem cell technology is more present and it's more allowed to do it also than on humans. You know, there's some, take some while that this would be also applicable also to the human kind of, And then it was also good to have Gino, which is like doing citizen science and is something in between of all this, you know. So then the second variation, because the project had like 2 variations. Like, so second variation, I call it like Aurelia von plus Hertz protos viva sonification, where it was more going on the transfer between the me and jellyfish. So we are actually performing together. And first I show the video, then I talk further. And I don't mind if you ask me also during my talk some questions, or later on with Nora, we said that we will have also some more debate. So it's like a variation of the same project, but it's more like a live performance. Because during my stay in Izmir, we did also lots of sound recordings. Like, try to have like good sound recordings of audio presence or sound presence of jellyfishes also in the water, and also like we have been trying to figure it out how do they react back to the sound. Because like there is one very interesting okay, I'll let you know to see this a bit. So it's a combination of the raw sounds which they have been collected on the field exploration. So we did lots of experiments in the lab and also in the sea, because in the sea was like lots of swarms of jellyfish at that moment. And there is also variation of my editing of this song. So it's like raw, it's kind of like archive songs which they are playing in different groups. So me and jellyfish, we are trying to get some composition together, I would say, you know. But anyway, you know, like also that there is a visual thinking to have this kind of transfer with the animal, which we don't know, like we don't feel so we don't feel so present. You know, like it's really hard to have this kind of transfer with jellyfish, like you have it with